This episode of The Color of Light is brought to you by Happy Valley. If the Rocky Neck Art Colony were a galaxy, artist Mary McGarrity Shore would be a star glowing at its center, lightly touching everyone in this mid-20th century community of artists and thinkers on Cape Ann. But Mary Shore also had an extraordinary artistic friendship far beyond Cape Ann. The eldest of eight children, Mary McGarrity was born in Philadelphia in 1912. Mary McGarrity studied at Cooper Union and the Chicago Art Institute, after which, married by then to John Shore, she settled in Gloucester, Massachusetts. The range of Shore's experiments with light, color, line, space, and materials confirm a powerfully intelligent eye, a lyrical touch, and an artist who never stopped believing that making art means asking questions. In 1947, Shore and friends helped transform the traditional Gloucester Society of Arts into the Cape Ann Society of Modern Artists. She exhibited her work with Albert Alcalay and Gordon Goodman, considered two of the greatest painters from this period on Cape Ann. Shore was close with poet Charles Olson, the sovereign chief of Gloucester's avant-garde. While he was away from Gloucester teaching, Olson wrote affectionate letters to Shore that reflect his respect for her as an artist and a friend. East Gloucester artists and neighbors Helen Stein and Nell Blaine were two of Shore's dearest confidants and colleagues. Gloucester's poet laureate Vincent Farini, also a local framer, created frames for Shore's works. And, after Mary and John Shore divorced, for a very short time, Vincent Farini was married to Mary Shore. But there is an entirely separate and surprising dimension to Shore's personal life, which reflects in the sculptural assemblages she created with scavenged materials. Also summering in that East Gloucester neighborhood were artist friends Teresa Bernstein and William Meyerowitz, who spent their winters in New York City teaching and working. In the 1920s, sculptor Louise Nevelson, considered one of the most important artists of the 20th century, studied with Bernstein and Meyerowitz in New York. Nevelson later became famous for her large monochromatic constructions from scavenged materials. It is assumed that Shore met Nevelson, 12 years her senior, through these East Gloucester friends. Brian Shore, Mary Shore's son, remembers by the early 1950s helping his mother and Louise Nevelson scavenge for all kinds of driftwood and materials on Niles Beach. In her biography of Louise Nevelson, author Laurie Lyle says of the artist, "She developed a lifelong friendship with a young painter named Mary Shore, who lived in Gloucester, Massachusetts, with her husband and two sons. Mary was a beachcomber, and every few months, she loaded her station wagon with sea refuse and took it to Louise in New York. If the weather was good, the two might drive back to Gloucester together." Brian Shore remembers that Louise would set up a table with large baskets in their yard to sort all the beach scraps they had collected over days, imagining and choosing what would work best in her pieces. Shore introduced Charles Olson to Louise Nevelson. Lyle recounts a night in Gloucester with these three that ended with Olson attacking Nevelson for being famous. Nevelson walked out, refusing to ever see Olson again, and she did not, in spite of his written apology. Certainly, the Nevelson friendship supported Shore beyond Gloucester. In 1949, Mary Shore had a one-person show at the Norlist Gallery in New York City, where Nevelson also showed. The Norlist Gallery was founded by Jimmy Ernst, son of the surrealist painter Max Ernst. Jimmy Ernst was also secretary to Peggy Guggenheim. In 1947, a group of prominent national artists like Stuart Davis and Edward Hopper founded the Artists' Equity Association. The mission was to address business and economic issues that affected artists, such as providing health insurance. Shore's friend Louise Nevelson was president of the New York chapter. Mary Shore served as national director. You cannot look at this friendship without looking at Shore's and Nevelson's work. Certainly, the exchanges within the two women's friendship left unassailable marks on each other's pieces. Brian Shore remembers Nevelson telling him that parts of the wooden pieces he had found on Niles Beach are in the Museum of Modern Art. And certainly parts of Nevelson's friendship appear in Mary Shore's creations. They are more intimate and lyrical than Nevelson's, but they also refer to Nevelson's architecture, symbolism, and totem-like forms. But perhaps it is really the Gloucester Sea, the endless gifts the surf offered freely to these two artist friends, that connects all.